standing by.
Good morning, everybody, and huge apologies for the lack of stream this morning. I'm not sure what the problem is. It's well beyond my pay grade. Could have been aliens, could have been gremlins, could have been incompetence, could have been, well, any number of complicated things that are beyond my understanding. My name is James Hendry. On camera today is Brian Ahab Joubert. He has covered himself in a purple bandana slash scarf thing. He looks like something out of the Arabian Nights. Anyway, it's very interesting, and that's his thumb, which is similarly purpley coloured. You're on a live safari, in case you're wondering what this ridiculous thing is that you happen to be looking at, and you're in the middle of the Kruger National Park, believe it or not, where the sun has just popped up over the horizon. That's it there, that big yellow thing hanging in the sky behind us. We haven't found any animals yet, so you haven't missed out on anything. You are on live safari, like I say, so please do talk to us over the course of the next, well, two and a bit hours. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. One is Twitter and one is email, in the order in which I gave them. The other feed, if you like, out today is Stefan the Mystic Winter Farmer. He is on foot today with Jandre. He of the enormous calves and buffalo-like footsteps. They will be sneaking as quietly as Jandre is able through various parts of the bush today, tracking things and showing you the smaller aspects of the wilderness here. Well, that's all I have to say to start with now. Let's move a little bit forward and see what we can find. We've come into this particular area hoping to find tracks of the great Queen Karula. She, of course, our mainstay of leopard viewing, the 12-year-old female and her two little cubs. And we're hoping that we might just about see them. They are heading towards, of course, their fourth month. Yes, it's their fourth birthday, I think, tomorrow. Fourth month birthday tomorrow, which is quite interesting. Okay, on we go. Brian, are you ready?
I am ready.
Where did you get that thing on your head?
At the shops.
It's very attractive, Brian.
Thank you. Do you like it?
I think it's most impressive.
A little bit, yeah.
Yes. That's the end of what is wrapped around Brian's head. It's like a sort of turban, if you like. He looks a little bit like Harbhajan Singh, of course, the great Indian off-spinner. I see no tracks of any leopards. There are tracks of honey badgers and many zebras. But that's about all. It's about 18 degrees Celsius, which is 65 or so degrees Fahrenheit, and 64 or 5, yes. And Brian and I both thought it was going to be about 8 degrees colder than it is now. 8 degrees Celsius colder. That's why Brian has got a turban on his head, and I've got a woolly hat upon mine. Oh, and thank you also for all of your welcome backs, those of you who didn't see the two of us yesterday afternoon. And let us not forget, of course, in the final control, we have Kirsten McLennan-Smith, who is also recently back from leave. She's being helped by Geraldine Chesterfield. There we go, look at that. Oh, this is a wonderful sighting. It was a wonderful sighting of the green wood hoopoe. There we go, there's one there. They don't normally sit still for any length of time at all. And I think there's a little bit of a bird party here. Now what they're doing, everybody, we'll just get closer, is they're gleaning. They're probing. They've got those long orange beaks and they're using them to probe underneath the bark for insect larvae. There's one there, still on the bottom there. See him probing away with that bright orange carrot-coloured beak. Used to be called the red-billed wood hoopoe, which of course makes a lot more sense than the green wood hoopoe. That is an inescapably ungreen bird, wouldn't you say, Brian? Yes. Now, of course, a larva, for those of you who don't know, a larva is something like a caterpillar. A caterpillar is a larva of a butterfly, and so every beetle that there is has a larva, which is a sort of grub, I guess. What might be termed a cutworm or a grub, often subterranean, but often the wood borers will put their grubs in the middle of the sort of soft bark of a tree like the silver cluster leaf. And it don't stand much chance against that beak, inside of which is a very sort of hard, sticky, probing tongue. Right, that's a good start, Brian. I see the light is already quite blinding, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
There are some hornbills having a little bit of fun. And they love having the sun on them, these hornbills. They're always sitting topmost for to catch the first rays, even on a not so chilly morning like this. Mm-hmm. James Richard, a nice question from you. Which bird of prey do I think is the most numerous in this area? I wonder. Let me think carefully. I think you'll probably find that it's a tawny eagle. No, I don't think it is. Well, tawny's probably up there, but I think you'll probably find it's one of the vulture species. They do tend to gather in quite large numbers here. Of course, Juma and the Arethusa to the west of us where we traverse and Cheetah Plains to the east would contain a limited number of nests. So when we say the most numerous bird of prey, I mean, we're going to say resident sort of birds of prey. Yeah, let's go with the white-backed vulture. I think that's probably the most numerous. Scavenger is normally going to be slightly more numerous than an actual killer, if you like. So it's not surprising that the tawny eagle is probably the most numerous eagle species that we get. And there's a lovely sighting of a magpie shrike on the bush in front of us there. Dina, yes, there indeed are other types of hoopoe. There's one other type of hoopoe that we get here, and that is called the unsurprisingly African hoopoe. And then we also, well, we don't get any other kinds of hoopoe here, but there are two other kinds of hoopoe. Well, I suppose you could call the scimitar bill a hoopoe. So we get maybe three types, and then there's one other. I'll show you pictures of all of them once we've finished looking at that magpie shrike. Hopping about, catching insects on the ground. Right, here we go. These are all the hoopoes that we get here, Dina. There is the African hoopoe. He's a very distinctive bird, and I mean, you get something similar in the UK and probably much of Europe, just called a standard issue hoopoe. And there is a scimitar bill. We get a scimitar bill there. And then that's the greenwood hoopoe there. And those are the three that we find here. And then you also get the southern violet wood hoopoe if you happen to go to Namibia. And that is looks very much like the green wood hoopoe. And much more appropriately named, I feel. Yes. There it is. Righty, on we go. Siberia, you ask a nice question about whether or not a fish eagle is more numerous when there's more water. I don't think so. I think they're probably just more frequent visitors, and that's why we tend to see them more. So certainly they're not territorial like the other eagles will be. Well, they can't afford to be because, of course, water here is ephemeral. It's temporary. It's just not always around. And so I think you'll find that, yes, while their numbers do increase, during the sort of rains and when there are puddles about and when the dams are full, I don't think that they get any more numerous. They're not sort of resident. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. And make sure that I've got my volume knobs working. Yes, there we go. and Cassie Lyon on the subject of birds of prey. You want to know if we get ospreys here. I suspect that osprey have been seen here at various times. They are certainly not common though. And they'd be unusual here because there are no really large bodies of water. We're a little bit far north for the osprey. And they have been seen, I know, around the Sand River lodges, so Singita, Londolozi, those sort of areas. But not commonly, but they have been seen. Much more likely to see them down in Natal, around coastal areas and sort of permanent inland lakes. There you'll find an osprey. But they're again of migratory, of course, so they wouldn't be around now. They'd be back in Europe, as far as I'm aware. And Joey, you're in Australia, where I imagine it is. Well, it's quite late in the day on this, the first day of June 2016 of the Common Era. Brian and I were just saying how astounded we are that the year is almost halfway through. I guess the older you get, the more common it is for you to say that the time has passed. It has got nothing to do with Joey's question, which is about the barbets that we get here. Joey, we get two kinds of barbets here. Well, maybe three. No, maybe four, actually. We get the crested barbet, and I'll show you a picture of them once we get into the clearing here. Crested barbet, we get a pathetically named black-collared barbet. We probably get the yellow tinker barbet sometimes, going ding, 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 ding. And then we'd also get the acacia pied barbet from time to time. I'll show them all to you. They're heavy-billed, fruitarian or fruit-eating birds, and as such, they've got very heavy bills. They're able to dig into wood, which many of the birds aren't. So many of the hole nesting birds, like woodland kingfishers or those hoopoes, don't dig their own holes in trees. That's normally done by woodpeckers and barbets, and then many other birds use those holes once they're sort of vacated. And I shall show you a picture of all the pretty barbets that we get here. Lots of yellow and red colors on them. So there were tracks of Karula going into this area. Now, just to give you an idea of where we are, we're kind of on the right hand. We're on the western edge of Juma. And this is where the two territories of Shadow and Karula tend to overlap slightly. And so it would be interesting to find that Karula had taken it upon herself to come back into this area. Likewise, I think Brent did manage to get a brief view of Shadow's cub the other day, which is really exciting. I'm hoping to see her too. Let's head across to Steph so he can greet you with the sunshine and a buffalo.
All right, and you've been with James this morning, and while we've been here on top of quarantine waiting for a chance to say hello to you, we've got some buffalo here, but these buffalo have been quite wary of us at the moment. They've moved around us and has given us a chance now to show you what's going on. I'm Stefan Winterboer, and I'm hosting the Sunrise Bushwalk this morning with Jandre Gerding behind the camera. Now buffalo, they're okay on foot as long as you establish respect. Now we respect them, that's the rule. Buffalo don't have to respect us on foot, we have to respect them. And the reason for that is that buffalo can be quite unpredictable, they can also be quite dangerous. At the moment, as you can see, they're actually not taking any notice of us whatsoever. And that's because we're staying way outside a comfort zone called the alert zone. Now, as soon as I cross that, they will stop doing what they're doing and they will look at us. And you can see that one buffalo there, the one there at the back, he's just busy having a look at us now. I think it's just because we're following him, but you can see there, goes right back to doing what he's doing. So we're right on the edge of that comfort zone. And that's really where I want to be. I want to be in a position where we, you and myself, can share walking through the bush with a herd of male buffalo without having an impact on what they do. And that is a situation that I love being in the bush, where we can share on foot the magic of being with animals like this, almost as if we were behaving like those animals. We're now going to come to a point where we've got another elevated position down the road. There's a termite mound there. And just want to come into the open here a bit. So what's happened is that buffalo right at the back there is taking a little bit of offense at us following him. And you can see that head up, not quite a threat display. He needs to know that we are respecting that distance, and that's exactly what we've just shown him right there, is that we're not going to approach him. He very clearly said to me there, hey man, I'm not comfortable with this distance, make some more. And as soon as he realized we weren't approaching, he carried on doing what he's doing. So we're skirting that line once again, and that's where we're really going to try and stay. So we're going to head to this termite mound there. It's the place of the most safety for us. Elevated positions. And although these buffalo are not really showing me any sort of sign that they are, hold on, any sort of sign that they are anything but calm, you've always got to maintain that respect. As you can see there, they got into some thicker bush there, and that immediately allows them to feel a little bit more secure than if they were, for instance, standing in the open grassland. Now, the trick here is to know when you've overstayed your welcome. It's very easy with buffalo, or any animal for that matter of fact, to overstay your welcome. And we've been with these buffalo for a good 10 minutes already. When we were waiting for you on the termite mound, they walked right up to us just to show that they're not scared of us. And then they carried on moving off. And now we've walked with them a little bit, and they've allowed us very kindly share some of that magic with them. Yeah, Kathy, you're incredibly right over there. These big guys can really get going when they really want to. The charge speed for an adult bull buffalo like this is 55 kilometers per hour. Now, 55 kilometers per hour is probably around about 40 miles an hour, which as far as I know is like the speed limit of most inner cities. So these guys, they're weighing in and around the 1,500 pounds, can move their bulk the same speed that a small city car can. And I tell you, it's frightening when they come at you. Buffalo obviously don't want to just kill everything that they come across. And while it is dangerous to walk into these buffalo without the proper knowledge, for us to do so is a bit of a calculated risk over here. What we're doing is we're making sure that the wind is always in our favor. The wind has been blowing from them to us, which means we're not washing our scent, our dinner from last night and our body soap and our detergents in our clothes. We're not washing onto these buffalo and making them feel nervous with an out of place smell. Secondly, we're keeping ourselves in the open, which means that for those buffalo, they can continually judge and gauge what type of threat we actually are, if anything at all. And then thirdly, I'm having a look at their behavior, and their behavior is key. I'm having a look for that head up and that aggressive stance, looking at us, maybe posturing sideways. And as you can see, those buffaloes have presented us with that. Really, me looking at what they are presenting us over there is actually just a tick against how we're doing this right. It's something that says to me, we're actually behaving exactly as we need to be with these buffalo. Head down, backsides towards us, and feeding. Couldn't be better. Oh, Sandy has just asked me, is it true that buffalo kill 500 people a year? Sandy, I'm not too sure where you get that statistic from. It's the first time that I'm hearing that statistic. You're welcome to actually just copy and paste it, and why don't you send it to questions@wildearth.tv as an email, and I'll share the source if you can. If it's it might be in the hunting industry worldwide, it could be in the buffalo breeding industry in South Africa. There's very many industries that I don't know too many statistics about, but if you want to, you can send it through to that email address and I'll share it to the rest of the viewers. I'll send it to our Twitter handle, the hashtag SafariLive. That's also a good place to put comments and things. All right. These buffalo are slowly moving now away from us, and I want to see if we can get a little bit closer onto that termite mound there. They still haven't given me an indication that we've overstayed our welcome. Signs that I'd be looking for that would be them walking now towards us. or running away. But they're doing none of that. They're sort of just feeding through this thicket. Let's have one last look at these guys through the thicket. As you can see, not doing too much. Except for that one guy at the back there, which has given us the hairy eyeball, so to say. But on that note, I think it would be a good time to send you back through to James for an update.
Well, from a buffalo to an impala, everybody, here. We have a little herd in front of me, and it's largely made up of females, of course, and there's one male there, and I suspect very strongly that he is now wasting his time. Those that are going to be pregnant are already. Those that are not going to be for the next season, until perhaps that secondary mating season in September. Now, I know that there are one or two new viewers watching at the moment. These, of course, the most common antelope that we get here. And interestingly, they've just finished what we call the rut. We will still see the males fighting. They will still sort of challenge each other and try and herd the females into their little harems. But mostly, in the Kruger area, they will breed or mate during the dark phase of the moon in May, which, of course, we've just passed now. And there just gives you a bit of an indication as to why they're the most common antelope we have here. You've seen two different impala, one eating on grass, the other eating on leaves. They are mixed feeders and able to eat both browse and graze, which of course is very unusual. Many animals, most animals are one or the other, with sort of brief forays into the world of a alternative cuisine, if you like, but largely they're specialists, whereas the impala is a generalist. But as with all animals, there is always some sort of limiting factor. There's always some kind of con to whatever strategy you come up with. And what the limiting factor for impala is water. And that's one of the main reasons that they are so common in the Sabi Sands and the Kruger National Park, is because of the provision of artificial water. They wouldn't be nearly as numerous as they are if there weren't so many dams and pans and pumped water holes in the area. Just some lovely light filtering through the trees there. And Kerry, while we're chatting about water, I'm just going to sneak slightly forward, Brian, because I think there's something else I want to talk about. Kerry, you want to know about permanent water in the area, and do we get permanent water? Are there any permanently flowing rivers? Kerry, there are, not through Juma where we are now. There are no flowing rivers here, either in summer or in winter, but down to the south, about 7 kilometers from where we sit now, so about 5 miles, just under 5 miles, there is the Sand River. That is a perennial river most years. It did dry up during the drought this year, and I suspect it will do again now, but that is a semi-perennial river, if you like. It would have been perennial before the advent of agriculture up in the catchment area. And then there is the Sabi River to the south of that, which makes the southern boundary of the Sabi Sands. And that is a perennial river, yes. And that flows all the way into the Kruger and I think eventually into the Crocodile River, if I'm not mistaken. So there are a number of perennial rivers through the Kruger Park, the Limpopo in the far north, the Luvuvu in the, which is also far north, but it's not the northern boundary, of course. Then there's the Olifants, which is a major river running through the middle of the park. Again, unfortunately, because of our human activities, it's now a very toxic river. And this, of course, is an effect that many of the mining companies and agricultural operations that operate in the catchment area don't think about, is the downstream effects of their activities. The Letaba River, just to the north of that, is another perennial one, also not in a great state because of toxins. And then in our area, we go into the Sabi and the Sand Rivers. And those are the major ones that flow through the Kruger National Park. Ooh. Just listening to Steph. Okay, Steph can hear a kudu calling near basically where we came from before we went live. That's around about where Treehouse Dam is. We're going to turn around there. He obviously can't, he can get there, but he's going to get there a lot slower than us because he is on foot, obviously. He's also moving with Gendre the calves. You don't want to be walking too fast with heavy things like that. So we're going to turn around and go into that area. I'm just going to let Steph know. Steffi, we'll make our way into that area as well. And then we'll see if we can't find what that kudu was shouting at. Now, if you are a new viewer, an alarm call is basically a shout that an animal or a bird makes. Whoops. An animal or a bird makes when it sees something that might want to eat it. So in the case of a rattling cisticola, for example, that goes pee, 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 pee. Impala make a loud snorting noise. That's a terrible, terrible impression of it. And then kudu and nyala and bushbuck make a bark. And it sounds almost like a dog, unless you're very close by. And it's the low frequency of those barks, because they, of course, are browsers. They make a low frequency bark that travels through the trees. The lower the frequency it seems, the easier the sound will get through thick bush. Well, we're not too far from that area, so let's pop along there and have a look. I didn't see any tracks when we went past there, but maybe that situation will change. That would be marvelous. Ryan, leopards, I feel.
Me too.
Hello, Justin. Welcome to the safari this morning. You want to know what some of the rarer sightings that I've seen in this reserve are? Well, in my current time at Juma, I guess the rarest sighting I've had has been a sort of 10-minute sighting of a serval, which is an unusual cat. They're not that uncommon, but we just so seldom see them. They're normally slinking off into the bush. But this was they're beautiful cat, sort of leopard-coloured, golden-coloured, with longitudinal black spots, just bigger than a sort of standard-issue house cat. And just before I went on leave, David and I had the most amazing sighting of a serval for about 15 minutes. So that would have been one of the rarer things that I've experienced here. Brent, of course, the other day had a pangolin, which everybody asks jokingly to see and nobody ever expects to. And that was again with David. A magnificent sighting of a pangolin, which is like a sort of a squashed armadillo, if you like. They're quite long and they've got very hard keratin scales on them. So I guess those would be the two most obvious ones. But of course, you're always going to see, especially in a wet year. So I mean, we're hoping for a wet year this year, come November. Then you're going to see all sorts of weird and wonderful things. So you'll see frog species that you don't normally see. You'll see bird species that will come in specifically because of the rain and the long grass that will pop up and the insects that will come. And so then you'll see things that are really unusual. Dry years like this, it's not that common to see very unusual things because, of course, the general diversity will be lower the drier it is. Nice question, thank you. Right, we're going to turn now down to the south, retrace our steps towards Treehouse Dam. So we'll just give you a look now as to where Treehouse Dam is. We're currently, here are some leopard tracks going up and down. So basically we are at a junction called Balanites Junction, down to the east of us there is Rebecca's Road, and then we've got Zoe's Road going down that way. And we're going to head towards Treehouse Dam. And you'll have a look at the map now and see what that looks like while I just check out these tracks that seem to be going up and down here. Female leopard, not fresh. Let's just reverse slightly. These tracks have been walked upon by a human being who spotted them, I suspect, a day or two ago. I know Brent, he spent a little while in this area. having a look-see. So they are going up and down. Now that's quite interesting. A leopardess normally goes up and down only if she's got a reason to go back to a certain area. And of course the two leopards in this area that would have a reason to go back, well, that reason of course is their cubs. I think the fresher ones are going this way, although it's very difficult to tell. Let's just drive slowly down this road. See, look in the trees, Brian, see there's the leopard cub dangling. I don't see any dangling leopard cubs at this stage. So quite nice that we get those maps and you can see where we are. You can see the extent of where we're driving. So that distance between where we were and Treehouse Dam, which is where we're kind of going now, is about, well, as the crow flies, only about a kilometer, I suppose. But as we drive, almost 2 kilometers. I'm just going to keep an eye out on the road here, and then we'll carry on. This is one of my favorite views off to the east here. And just interesting where the sun is now. There you can see the sun. And the sun would be basically on your right-hand side of your picture in summertime. So it'll move right to the south, to the right-hand side of your picture there. Now, Callum, you're in Australia and you say, would the animals out here survive there? The answer is most certainly not. You say the bush looks quite similar. It does look similar, I agree with you. From the pictures, I've not been to Australia, but from the pictures I've seen of Australian landscapes, I can see exactly what you mean. But remember, the suite of species here is very different in terms of leaves. You've got a lot of eucalyptus there in Australia. Very few animals can actually cope with eating eucalyptus, the koala being a notable exception. None of the browsers here would be able to cope with the oils in a eucalyptus tree, and that is why, I mean, we have exotic plantations of Australian trees that we use for paper largely. They're eucalyptus plantations, and they are almost lifeless in this area because there's no indigenous fauna that is able to cope with the kind of aromatic leaves of the eucalyptus. So while there might be one or two species that could cope, I think you'll find that very few would survive. I mean, the great example, of course, of imported animals into Australia that have absolutely thrived were, I think it was rabbits, wasn't it? Rabbits were imported there and they went ballistic, and because there were no natural predators, so they obviously found plenty to eat. But I think that you'd find things like kudu and impala and zebra, maybe the grazers would do a bit better, but I think any of the browsers would really struggle. It's a nice thought, that. Australia, of course, is very, I remember a physiologist, we had a fascinating physiology lecturer at Varsity who wasn't the most pleasant fellow in the world, but he's very clever, as many clever people are often not very pleasant. And he told us many things about Australia, and there's a wonderful book, which I've yet to find actually, called The Future Eaters. And it's basically about Australian fauna and why it jumps about the way it does, and why it doesn't walk like any self-respecting fauna in the rest of the world. And one of the reasons, of course, is that Australia is extremely nutrient poor as a continent. It doesn't have very rich soils. In fact, they're very poor soils, and that means that energy balance is very difficult, and you have to move extremely efficiently in the case of the hopping marsupials. That hopping motion is a very efficient way of moving, or not at all. In the case of the koalas, who hardly move around at all. Australian life is really very interesting indeed. I don't mean the human version. Well, that's quite interesting too, but for different reasons. I mean the wildlife. No further leopard tracks here. I'm going to drive a little bit faster now and see if we can't get around the corner. See if we can pick up any more sound of barking kudus. We'll stop if we find anything else on the way. Brian, there's some helmet shrikes there. I don't know if you've got a view there. Yes, very nice. There's a helmet shrike, everyone. We're in a good position here to just stop and have a bit of a listen. So we'll observe the helmet shrikes briefly. And I also want to show you the barbets. I remember I was going to show you the barbets. And all around you can hear the very quiet sort of dawn chorus of the winter, mainly made up by the woodwind section of some magpie shrikes. Bleep, 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 bleep. No, that's not a magpie shrike. That's a... that's ridiculous. It's a grey hornbill. Right, here are our barbets. Very beautiful birds. That's the most common one. That's the crested barbet there. And there's the black-collared, which should, of course, be called the red-faced, don't you think, Brian?
Yeah.
Ridiculous that it's called the black-collared. There's the acacia-pied barbet, much more subtly covered, but you can see they all have very heavy bills, heavy beaks, and then we get the yellow-fronted tinker barbet there, or tinker bird. And it's the most lovely sound of the summer to hear them going, there we go. You see how I cleverly changed my hat there, Brian?
I did.
So that my bald spot didn't blind everyone.
Yeah.
It's very considerate of me, I feel.
It is.
Yes. Now, Aaron, you want to know if I have a favourite water bird. Favourite water bird. I suppose I do. I suppose my favourite water bird would be the green-backed heron. Mainly because it's so clever at fishing. It's a remarkable bird that uses bait. It will take an insect and drop it into a pond where it's seen fish rising and then wait on the side. And as the fish rises to grab the insect, it'll grab the fish. Brilliant, brilliant strategy. And putting pay to the notion that only humans or higher primates use tools. I did see an impala looking a little nervous, so we'll keep going slowly along here. Laura, you're continuing the bird discussion, which is marvellous. You want to know if all raptors are water dependent. Is that correct? Is that the question? Raptors. And the answer would be no, not at all. Many of them would be water independent because they will get plenty of moisture from the prey that they kill. I suspect many of the scavengers are probably a lot more water dependent than the birds of prey that kill their own food, because of course a drying carcass is a bit like eating beef jerky as opposed to fresh watery moist steak, which is what many of the raptors eat. So no, not water dependent, and many raptors make a very good living in desert areas, mainly because their prey is water dependent, and so they find it pretty easy to catch prey around the water holes. The falcons, the peregrine and lanner falcons, being great examples of birds that lurk around water, and they nail doves and grouse. Marianne, you want to know if I can make the call of the white-browed scrub robin, because you say that you don't know if you're hearing it or not at the Juma Dam cam. I can try, otherwise I'll play it for you, but it goes... and then it can also go... that's normally only in the evenings. Marianne, does that sound like what you're hearing? I can play it for you, a probably slightly better version of the bird itself calling. But that's the one bird call that I can do relatively okay. It wouldn't fool a scrub robin, but it might fool a human. That light has got very bright very quickly. Alas, there don't seem to be any large predators here. We'll just go to the top of the hill here and then I'll turn. This particular day this morning. Come on, Rusty. Some very disturbing knocking sounds coming from the bottom of this vehicle. That's not good. Something's going to fall off soon. No. This is round about where Steph heard them, so we'll just keep watching the road, see if there aren't any tracks going across. If not, we shall continue down towards the southern boundary. I don't see anything further here. All right, while we investigate this area, let's go across to Steph, get an update from him. He'll tell you exactly where he heard those kudu.
Now, some of the times it's just nice to wander, and we're wandering through this beautiful parkland that we've got here at the moment. It's not natural parkland. This has been created for us on the western end of quarantine. And it does just allow us, though, to enjoy an uninterrupted vista as we move through the bush here. And why I've come here is right about a minute or two ago, we've had impala that have just gone through a little bit of a succession change. And what I mean by that is that during the rut, which is what we're having at the moment, we're actually coming to the tail end of the rut. During the rut, male impala will often fight with one another, and a top-ranking male, when he loses, doesn't just lose a position, but jumps down the pack. And that happens at, or it happens like that, because second or third ranking male will have a fight, one male will be usurped, and all of a sudden every other male has a chance to go at that male, quite often resulting in quite serious injuries for these impala. It's not uncommon to see impala with one eye, as Nelson the impala shows us. It's also not uncommon to see impala with broken horns, as Nelson also has. I think he also has only one horn. And then injuries to their neck and to their thoracic region is actually very common. But we heard that happening, and I want to come here and see if we can actually see them. Now, it happened here on the open area, but they've sort of fought with one another into the thicket here, and that is exactly where we want to come and have a look now and see if we can't find them. All right. Been a pretty quiet morning over here where we're standing at the moment, barring those buffalo that actually we were with a little bit earlier. We haven't heard much. Haven't heard any lion this morning, haven't heard any elephant breaking branches. Been pretty quiet. We did hear the kudu alarm call, that's exactly right. We heard the kudu giving alarm call, but it was a couple of short, sharp barks, and they haven't actually made another noise since then. Nevertheless, doesn't mean that there's nothing here. I want to have a look at this, see what is happening here. This termite mound has obviously been damaged by something. There's no real sign of what's damaged it. Only real thing that I can say is probably it was pulled apart by an aardvark. The aardvarks have got, or ant bears, have got these really long, sharp front claws. What they got three of them on their front feet. What they'll do is they'll come up to a termite mound and they start scraping. And they scrape a little bit and then they snuffle up the termites. And you can actually almost see where he's scraped this chimney open, and he's come and he's scraped the chimney. And that's what's left that sand. All the termites inside here would have rushed up to see what the intruder was and to try and chase it away. He would have then lapped it up with his tongue. He's got this long, darty tongue, lapped it up. and snuffled up the termites. And then the termites would have realized, hang on, wait, this is an ant bear. We can't fight this. And they would have retreated and sealed the tunnels up behind them. And they would have left this empty cavity as we have here. We have got a hare here, though. Have a look at that. So, that may come from an aardvark. Now, aardvarks are generally considered to be quite hairless, but the hairs that they do have are this color and this length, especially on their tails. Now, for those of you with some screen grabs, you're welcome to... Oh, I've got flies buzzing around my face again. You're welcome to take some screen grabs of this particular hair and see if we can identify it. There's the follicle, even at the bottom, plus the slight rusty brown color that you see at the top here. I'm going to say that this is definitely remnants of the ant bear. As he was digging open the hole, he left some of the hair from his forearm stuck in the mud here. And that is what we're seeing right now. Obviously, quite old sign. This isn't very fresh at all. This wasn't done last night. This was done a long time ago. But just me using the sights and sounds, using a bit of my intuition, we're able to deduce, or at least that's my guess. It's at best just an educated guess, and then not very educated at all. Chitra has just asked me quite an interesting question all the way from India. What are the chances of us looking at a basking snake while we're on walk? Chitra, quite good, especially this time of the year. So this time of the year, puff adders go from being nocturnal snakes to being diurnal snakes, daytime snakes. And very often, on a chilly morning, but one that's got promise to get warm, you see puff adders basking on the side of termite mounds, trying to get some heat before they go out for the day, trying to build up their metabolism. Summertime, or wintertime at least, is when the puff adders mate with one another, and you quite often find male puff adders on their forays looking for females. Male puff adders building up their metabolic heat early in the morning, and then basically moving in search of females throughout the day. Well, are we going to the bush over here and hopefully try and look for one of these things? We're going to go and link to James, who's got a bird to show you.
There were some birds over there, I promise. There were southern grey hornbills, and I'm so disappointed because they were, there they are, they were fighting with each other. It was just wonderful to watch. And then as, of course, you decided to have a look at them, they disappeared, which is what animals do out here, of course. There are two lilac-breasted rollers up there, but I think that's beyond the capabilities of this camera. You can't get up there, can you, Mark? Also enjoying the first rays of the sun. If you see them. I don't think you're going to be able to get them. No, sorry about that, everybody. Never mind. We'll continue to find something else. Let's see if we can't find these hornbills. We're on the road where we did see some kudu, by the way. Exactly where Steph said he thought he heard them alarm calling. We came basically in the opposite direction from the way that they are going now, hoping to see what they were shouting at. Nothing as yet and no tracks that I can see, but who knows, we might be lucky. There the hornbills are, and they're still fighting with each other. Look at them. These are two youngsters. They're smaller than adults, definitely. That's obviously only one of them, but the other one is just in a tree in front. So let's just sit here for a little while and listen. And see if they don't fight again. And the reason I know they're youngsters is that they're just smaller than the adults. There are four of them now. Just the one there, but in this sort of hidden in the silver cluster leaf to the left-hand side, there are another three. I think it's worth just sitting here for a few minutes to see if they continue their fight. It was really spectacular to watch. And then in the background, you can hear a white-browed scrub robin giving an alternative call. No, Brian, they're not going to perform for us. They're just going to sit there doing nothing. sunbathing. Oh, one of them went to the loo. That's very nice. That's the usual story, isn't it?
It is.
Oh dear. This is a bit of a problem. Right. So, the elephants have done a lot of this of late, and I think it's because there's no grazing for them. So they are bashing many of the trees over the roads. Well, they're bashing them all over the place, and sometimes there happens to be a road in the way. Let's go up through here. There's no very clear path, I must say. Anyway, we'll keep trying.
Watch your...
Hello, Kitra. You're in India. Lovely to hear from you all the way from India. And you say, do the hornbills here, like the hornbills you get there, nest in tree holes? Absolutely they do. They're exactly the same nesting behavior. That's fascinating. And I know you get a number of really interesting hornbills, well, throughout the Asian subcontinent and, of course, down further into Southeast Asia. Lots of different hornbill species. So, yes, indeed, they do nest in tree holes. Wonderful to hear from you all the way from India. Please keep talking to us. I'm going to go, of course, just getting around this one tree in the smooth motion is not easy. Here we go, Brian. We're going to go basically straight onto the road on top of it. It'll be okay this way. Go. This, of course, this is quite a nice example of a jackalberry tree here to the right-hand side, and it's been broken off a number of times. And you can see it's been broken by elephants because of the way it's growing, but it's managed to survive. It hasn't been debarked, and so it'll continue, hopefully, to become a wonderful ebony tree, which, of course, the iconic trees that we get here, very beautiful, and they produce lovely fruits. Kathy, you say that Brent would have just bashed through that tree. Brent might have bashed through that tree, but it is not surprising that Brent's record of vehicle destruction is roughly proportional to his speed and willingness to drive through bushes. So, well, you know, like with all strategies out here, pros and cons. Ryan also, of course, would have been detached by driving through that tree, and he'd be hanging in that black monkey thorn and possibly saying words that are not very nice, wouldn't you, Brian?
Yes, yes. I would berate you, James.
You would berate me deeply.
Yes.
Possibly physically.
Once I got out the bush,
yes. Yes. Right, we've got round. Sophie, you say you hope we actually see some elephants. Sophie, I hope dearly that we actually see some elephants as well. I'm starting to feel slightly, distressed by the fact that we've seen two impala the entire morning. Well, a few more than two, but not many more. Those trees look to be fairly recently pushed over, so maybe we'll be lucky. Those lions from last night, by the way, were calling sometime this morning, but I don't know where exactly. Hello, Linda. I half missed your question there, I'm afraid. But I think you asked about... Oh, you said you've heard that the hyenas may have moved in. And have they found a new one? I don't know. I haven't been up there. And I think it's probably a little bit late in the morning to be going up there now, because even if they hadn't moved in, they'll probably be inside. But certainly worth having a look maybe this evening. My friends, the hyenas, yes, I have missed them, I must say. I enjoy them so immensely. I just hoped to find some little leopard cubs this morning. That's why we didn't go up there. I did think about it. Anyway, we'll pop around a treehouse down. There's some relatively fresh elephant tracks on the road. Maybe an elephant, which that would be very nice to see, of course. Well, anything would be quite nice, wouldn't it, Brian? Any form of mammal. We were asked yesterday if we'd do a competition for mammal species. Well, I'd be winning over Steph. No, Steph would be winning. I think he's seen two, and we've seen one. That's a really pathetic return for the morning, for both of us. Steph at least has the excuse that he's on foot. Well, we're nearing Treehouse Waterhole now. Now sort of looks a bit like Treehouse Mine, but once the water does come, it will soften the outlook there. There are tracks of a very large elephant bull going along the road here. Maybe he's around. I'm getting that slightly quiet drive feeling, Brian.
It's not good.
It's not good, is it, Brian?
No.
No, it's dreadfully sad.
Dreadfully.
Terrifying. Oh, look at that, Brian. It's a wildebeest. Hold press. It's charging. Do you think we'll be okay?
I hope so.
Seems to have stopped charging. Everybody, I'm being completely sarcastic. Wildebeest will not charge the vehicle. Let me sneak forward so that you can actually see it. There we go. A wildebeest bull. And as with most wildebeest, he has a look of utter confusion on his face. That I don't believe is because he's confused, it just happens to be the slightly unfortunate manner in which he has been built. He's actually tremendously confiding. Most of them won't come close to us like this. This is wonderful. When we say something is unfortunate, it normally means they're ugly, of course. But I don't think wildebeest are ugly. Many do. They've been considered part of what is known as the Ugly Five.
Now you see, now look.
Yes.
He runs away.
He runs away. Just now, he'll go to the loo for us. There he goes. He's probably looking for water, you know, and of course there isn't any at the moment at Treehouse Dam. But, as Brent pointed out to me the other day, the elephants have started to excavate again where that natural spring does come up into Treehouse Dam. And we'll go and have a look at that now. Spiderweb on the lens, everyone. Sorry about that. Brian will remove it. That's Brian's fast hand there. Two mammals, Brian. What a win, hey? Right, here we are at Treehouse Dam. Where there is not a great deal. What I will do is drive up onto this rather impressive construction that is the wall. And I'll show you what I mean that Brent discovered. So if you look down there, everyone, just turn to your left and look down there. And what you can see is some fairly fresh examples of where the soil has been excavated. And that's by elephants. They're digging there, and you can see their dung. If we go a little bit wider around, you can see the dung there. The elephants are brilliant at finding water when there don't seem to, when there doesn't seem to be any, especially clean water. They don't like muddy, dirty water that's had hippo dung in it if they can avoid it, and so they will find underground water sources like this and dig for it. And it might actually be worth, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to go and stick my head in there, well, my hand, and see if I can find anything in the way of water. Brian, you'll keep me posted as to whether you can hear me or not, will you?
I shall.
Yes, thank you so much. I shall take this out. Right, here we go, everyone. I will now descend into the Kimberley hole. See how dexterous I am, Brian?
You're amazing.
It's like watching a mountain goat, isn't it?
It is.
Yes.
A very small mountain goat.
When one hears oxpeckers going and one is frolicking in the bush, one must think of one thing, and that, of course, is buffalo. You will tell me if you see a buffalo, will you, Brian?
I shall.
So there's some mud here. There isn't much water, but there is definitely mud. Here we go. There's water. There's water here. Are you zoomed in, Brian? I'll splash some for you. Here we go.
Oh.
Isn't that amazing?
Incredible. Wunderbar.
The elephants have managed to dig mud out here, and a whole lot of other animals have come to drink. So there are buffalo tracks.
Your audio is a bit dodgy.
And many other kinds of tracks of animals coming to have a drink. Now I'm going to have to get up this fairly substantial construction. Let me collect this. Hyenas, dreadful litterers.
There we go.
Well done. That's great. Amazed that there's water there. And the elephants do that, they can feel water, we think, flowing under the ground, and that's probably how they've managed to achieve what they have there. Okay. Here. Let me plug myself in again. Right, there we are. My ear in. Kirsten can shout at me. There we go, I'm back in. Kirsten, I can hear you. Right, now. Sorry, just one quick look with my binoculars. Right, just have a quick look here. Steph does have something to show you, but it doesn't appear to be mobile. So let me just have a quick look with you. I just thought I saw the shadow of something the other side there. It was a shadow, you know, of a tree. Trees do that. They do cast shadows. Mm. Right, on the subject of trees, let's head across to Stefan, who has a tree.
You know, even the most common tree, and this is what you're having a look at right now, is a marula tree, has a story to tell. And this particular tree has got quite a nice story to tell in that it's giving us a gauge on how exactly tall an elephant is. Now, elephants get big very quick the closer they get to you, but very often from a screen, even when we're viewing them over here on foot, or from a vehicle for that matter of fact, it's so difficult to get an accurate gauge on how tall they actually are. But this particular tree is telling a story on how tall an elephant actually is, and how it's telling that story is by the mud. There's a lot of mud here. There must be a wallow somewhere close to here, but all this brown that you're seeing over here is not the tree, it's actually mud. And what's happened here is an elephant has gone for a wallow. He's then walked up to this tree and he's used this tree as a loofah or a scratching post. And he's walked here and you can see from here there's no mud. And the reason for that is this is where the shoulder blade ends and the leg starts. And then here is where his belly is. This is where the belly or the shoulder of the elephant would be. And then right up there, which I can't even reach, which I'm going to use my rifle to show you, is where the neck was. There. That's the last piece of mud. There and there is the last piece of mud. Now that's a good, I don't know how, my rifle is probably 5 feet long and I'm 6 foot tall. So you're looking at a good 11, 12, 13 feet off the ground. What this elephant did was he came, walked up to this tree, rubbed against the tree, then had a big scratch of his belly, and then came and stuck his head on the tree like this and did this to scratch behind his ear. He would have taken his big ears, which I can probably demonstrate using my ear, but I've got big enough ears, this side of the tree, lent it forward, and then scratched behind his ear, getting all to those hard to reach places around the neck. And that is actually what's given us the height, was how high an elephant's head can lift, and easily can lift much higher than I am. As I said, I'm 6 foot tall. That's another 3 or 4 feet, plus another 2 or 3 feet all the way up there. Isn't that amazing? Another story that this particular tree has to tell is one that's pretty common to all marulas, and that is how to deal with infections, how to deal with parasites, how to deal with unwanted hosts. Now the biggest thing for a tree, the biggest thing is an unwanted host, mistletoe for instance. Another big thing with a tree is an infection, fungus. What a tree doesn't want is fungus or mistletoe on it. And the marula's got one of the most interesting ways of shedding that, of basically combating those two things. For mistletoe and for fungus, the tree sheds its bark, but doesn't shed its bark out. It doesn't peel off great slabs of bark. What it does is its bark pops off in these roughly circular discs. And you can see here where bark has popped off. It has fallen and is lying all over the floor here. This is one, two, I can pick off a couple of them. Here we go. These have popped off from various parts in the plant. I don't know, we can play some puzzle pieces, but that's basically what it looks like. Pops off and takes with it all of the fungus spores and all of the mistletoe seeds. And you can have a look over here. Look at what the bark has traveled with all the way down to the bottom of the tree and then gotten rid of it. But what it also does is it creates these little micro habitats where animals like to live. Now what I love doing is lifting up these little pieces. I feel for a loose one, and what I'm looking for are pseudoscorpions. They're one of my favorite insects, is a pseudoscorpion. But there's no loose ones on this tree. This elephant has done a cut. Oh, here we go. There's one that's coming loose. You can see it's starting to peel off. Obviously, as it loses touch with the tree, it loses its food and its source of water. It then dries up and it peels away from the tree, and that's what causes it to pop off. They pop off relatively easily. And what I'm looking for here is a pseudo scorpion. I normally only pop off one. I don't normally pop off another. And there are no pseudo scorpions under this one. So no luck today. But we will find one eventually. I'll definitely find a pseudo scorpion eventually. For those of you who want to see what one looks like, it's P-S-E-U-D-O and then scorpion after that. Pseudo scorpion. And you're going to have a look at them. They're very, very interesting little animals. Now, off on the walk again. Another thing that I like to look at and like to discover is these acacia trees. This time of the year, these acacia trees bleed quite a lot of sap, and they're one of the few trees around that can bleed sap at this time of the year. They got sort of sap spare, for lack of a better word. And have a look at this. That is now a very camouflaged caterpillar. I don't know what moth or what butterfly that is from. That black stripe that you see there is a caterpillar, a hairy caterpillar that's wrapped itself all the way around the branch. And when you look carefully here, we've got two. Now I'm going to fetch some grass so that I can point them out to you and to Jandre, because Jandre can't see them, they're that camouflaged. Where my grass is, this is a caterpillar. From there to there, wrapped around a branch. From there to there, sucking the sap of this tree. There's another one right here, Johnny. From there to there. But how insanely camouflaged are these caterpillars? I've actually never seen these caterpillars before. I wouldn't even begin to be able to tell you if they're from a moth or from a butterfly. You are welcome to help me identify them. Take a screen grab for those of you who can go through. There's actually three caterpillars here. And the more I'm looking, the more I'm seeing. Shonda, here's another one right here. Have a look at that, folks. There's one from there to there, another one from there to there, and another one from there to there, all within a very short space. Sucking on the sap of this tree, obviously just waiting for the sun to get a bit warmer before they start moving around, and using that superb camouflage that they have to obviously hide themselves from being picked off by birds this time of the year. All right, are we going to carry on going? And while we are picking our way through this bush, it'll be a good time to go back to James.
Well, we have found, we found evidence of a mammal, didn't we, Brian?
We did.
This is evidence of a mammal. This belonged to a mammal. It is obviously dead at this stage of its life, don't you think, Brian? Unlikely to have survived losing this bone. Now, in the middle of the bone, of course, is what the hyenas go for, and I suspect it was opened up by hyenas because only they have got jaws big enough to open up a bone like this. And what's interesting there is you can see that it was filled with marrow at one stage. Now, I'm fascinated by human history and human origins. And this marrow here is apparently what our human ancestors used to look for on the plains of East Africa. This is what they would try and eat. So quite apart from being hunters, they were largely scavengers. And as I've mentioned before, as those animals migrate in those huge numbers across the plains of East Africa, so they die more of natural causes than they do from the attentions of predators. And this resource here, this marrow resource, is all largely untapped, but for the things like hyenas that will go and break open the bones. Now, our human ancestors, much like us, were very clever in that they were able to... Elephant. Hooray. They're coming towards us. Let's wait for them to come towards us. We're not allowed to go off-road with them at the moment. So we're just going to wait for them to feed through here. So what they used to do is that they'd go along, they'd find a big rock, they'd crush this open and then suck out the marrow. Now, I don't know how many of you have marrow on toast every so often, but it's the most delicious meal. And what marrow contains, of course, is fat, a huge amount of fat. And that, everybody, quite apart from what most of literature will tell you, or pop literature, is the limiting nutrient for the human ancestor. It's why we lay on fat so readily, because it's in our genetics to store fat, because it's a limiting factor. And this was one of the only places that you could get fat, and you can get fat, from an African animal, because they don't lay down fat on top of the bones often, and there just simply isn't enough in their diet for them to do that. And this is where you find the fat. And in areas where animals died and there were great numbers of scavengers like human beings, or where there was sufficient for human beings to scavenge, women used to carry babies to term, because fat, of course, is a limiting nutrient for a pregnant woman. And after a long drought, when the carcasses of the dead animals were, had been denuded and eaten, what you found was that the birth rate of human beings disappeared. It really went down a long way, and that's because the women couldn't get fat like in this marrow. Anyway, that's a long story about a bone, which I think is quite interesting. You might think it utterly unfascinating, but there it is. Now, let's see if we can get a view of these elephants, or one elephant, hopefully walking this way. Now, we don't drive off-road for elephants anymore in an attempt to kind of minimize our impact during this particularly dry time of the year. If we'd had normal rain, we'd just drive in there and find him. But we're not allowed to do that at the moment. Brian, do you see the elephant?
Not yet.
Can you just stop again and have another listen? I can hear others long way away shouting. I think he might be going north. He's kind of moving through here. He might be at the old hyena den. Let's go there. We're not far from there at all. I'm going to drive a little bit faster. And Steph can hear others at the junction of Zoe's and Philemon's cut line. So we're in the right vicinity. We won't go backwards the whole way, everyone. Mainly because I'll get a crick in my neck. Being so old, Brian. Approaching my 40th year, of course. My fifth decade on planet Earth is approaching. Let's ease in here. And then we'll go Zoe's Philemon's cut line, the ones that Steph can hear, are quite a long way that way. Watch your head, everybody. Duck down, no thorns. All right, Brian?
All right.
Plenty of evidence of elephants in here. Should be right around here. But it's not. Let's stop and have another listen. I can't believe this. Yeah, he's over there. I can just hear him moving through the bush. Sophie, you say your wish is going to come true. I hope it is, Sophie. Your wish to see elephants. Let's just drive around here quickly. Watch out, everyone. Heads. Okay, Brian? Okay. Alas. Nope. No sign here, everyone. We'll go and try and find the ones that Steph heard. Sophie, sorry about that. I just heard them moving sort of through here. We might pick them up as we go through towards the Philemon's cut line, which is the road that we were on. But of course, animals come and go from all over the place. There are elephant tracks absolutely all over this area, so they have been around. Hold on, Brian. Very bumpy here. Oh, Justin. You want to know what kind of binoculars I would recommend you bring on safari. Now, I'm not allowed to mention the brand name, apparently. That's not allowed. But what I will tell you is that there is a very profound difference between the two pairs of binoculars now sitting on the front of this car. That one belongs to me. It was donated by a charity to another charity that I was working for that subsequently folded. The charity that donated them wasn't a particularly generous one. This pair was donated, well, not donated, lent to me by Kirsten McKinnon Smith, who is in the final control. That's because she doesn't need them in the final control. This is an exceptional pair of binoculars, and I won't tell you which one it is. But any one of Leica, Zeiss, or Swarovski, those are the kind of top end binoculars, and they're amazing. They're fantastic. This is a pair of binoculars you should avoid unless you are Erwin Rommel on the desert campaign, for example. I think that's where they come from. But you can get a very nice pair of binoculars that will set you back probably about, I don't know, say $200 or so. That's probably what you should be looking to spend, $200 to $300. And then you can get a really nice pair of binoculars that will immeasurably improve your safari experience. People say, what's the one thing that I should bring on safari? And my answer to them always is, before you pack your toothbrush, make the effort to go and get a pair of binoculars, because it really will change your impression of the bush. You can look at so much more and appreciate so much more out here if you have a decent pair of binoculars. There we go. Thank you for that, Justin. I haven't looked through these for a while. Yes. Elephant. Well done, Brian. They're moving parallel with the road. There we are. Hooray. A mammal. A large mammal. I think they're going to pop out here. I'll just stop in this gap on this bump. Go. There you are, Sophie. We do what we can, you know, don't we, Brian?
We do.
Let me just quickly call this in on the radio. The radio has been very quiet, so I don't think there's much going on. Stations, there's a small breeding herd of elephants mobile in a westerly direction parallel with Philemon's cut line towards the junction with Shibun. Quite a nice herd of elephants. One, two, three, count them, everyone. Four, five, six, in a line. That'll probably be the matriarch, that big one coming into picture now. She's young to be a matriarch. No, 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 here comes the matriarch. Much bigger. Much obviously older. There, she's just coming into your picture now. She's missing her right tusk, we know her. I've seen her before many times, her hips showing, just because she's quite old now. And interesting that she doesn't necessarily walk in front of the herd, but it is almost without question that it will be her that is giving the orders, telling them where to move. Let's go a little bit forward. There's a junction up ahead that they're going to cross. Lovely herd of elephants. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, I think. So one of the females just showing a little bit of displeasure. So I'm going to stop here. She took a few steps towards us. And as we've got closer to them, so they've become slightly more nervous. And the big cow at the back stopped and looked. There, that's the one that took a few steps towards us. Coming out now. She seems to have relaxed. That's the matriarch there coming out. That's her. It's so interesting to me that they see vehicles so often, and yet they are still nervous of cars. I will move forward. Let me just sneak forward now. We're not going to be able to follow them off-road, so we do need to get as good a view as we can here. Now, Kay, you want to know if elephants will ever attack their young? No, Kay, I don't think they will. It's not impossible that the bulls might kill youngsters, especially if they are not very mature bulls. sometimes immature bulls do attack youngsters and rhino and hippo and that sort of thing. But I think in amongst, you know, we know infanticide in mammals is quite common, but I think it's probably relatively uncommon in elephants. Look at them melting there into the bush. Now, Anya, you want to know, it's a nice question, especially as we just saw that elephant turn and run towards us and then she stopped. And you want to know how close you can get to animals when you are on safari. Anya, it depends entirely on the animal, and even, and I don't mean the species, I mean the up down to the level of the individual. So with some animals, especially some of the cats, you can park almost on top of them before they'll move, the lions specifically, so you can get pretty close to them. But some lions will be very upset with you if you get very close to them, so that really does depend on the animal. And then of course with elephants, some elephants will just mill around the vehicle and not pay any attention at all to you. That herd wasn't nearly that comfortable, so they wouldn't have let us do that. They would have probably moved away a lot before, you know, we got to closer than say 20 meters or 60 feet or so from them. So, and it really does depend on the animal, but we've got to read their behavior very carefully and make sure that we don't threaten them, because threatening an animal, of course, getting to within its comfort zone means that it will invariably either run away or it will turn around and run towards you, neither of which you really want. And it also depends, of course, on the experience that the animal has. So if, for example, many of the leopards of the area have become used to vehicles, they're habituated to vehicles, so we can get pretty close to them and they don't mind at all. But many of the other animals out here, if you see them for the first time, for example, you see a leopard, a young male leopard, for example, coming into the area for the first time. If it saw a vehicle, it would run away. And there is a male leopard that we've been trying to habituate. Unfortunately, we don't see him very often. But he lives up around Bivelshoek Dam, and we don't see him very often because he doesn't like vehicles. Sorry, I'm just going to have to get hold of the mic here. 1 second. What he's talking about. There is a battalier, but it has flown beneath the line of the trees. But it has gone away. There's just quite a lot of activity on the radio now, people asking about the hyena den and whether it's moved or not, so I don't know. Always wonderful to get back to these Twitter handles, and this one is not a new one, but it's fantastic. Blue Butterfrog. Blue Butterfrog, you say you didn't realize how much you enjoyed elephants until you started watching the safari. Yeah, I agree. I think that they are fantastic things to spend time with, especially extended periods. You get such an impression from them. You get a real feeling from them. And that cow that ran towards us there, I actually got quite a fright from it. I thought that it was they were very relaxed, and suddenly she turned and she got very cross, very quickly. And it's always something you've got to be aware of with elephants, but they give you an impression. And she very clearly gave us an impression there that she didn't want us any closer at all. Just to keep you posted, the bushwalk is down. I don't know what that means. I think it just means that they're having technical glitches. Right, we'll see what else we can find on our own out here. We're alone, Brian. All alone in the wilderness. There is another wildebeest, Brian. Quite possibly the same one who's just managed to cross this block. Don't run away, wildebeest, please. Beggars and choosers and all that. There he is. Hello. I think it's exactly the same fellow who's come across from the other side there. He's very, very disinterested in us, Brian.
Yeah, I can see,
see that.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Wildebeest. Wonderful sighting. Thanks for the effort you made. Show us your bottom. We should probably wait for him to see if he wants to deposit some dung, shouldn't we? Right, there we go. Oh, Justin. I don't know how rare it is that we might stumble across an animal that's giving birth. It's very rare. I've seen it once in about 12 years knocking about this area. A number of my colleagues have seen a wildebeest or an impala giving birth, but normally only once, and it's not common at all. Now that's, I mean, it's quite interesting because they will give birth often during the day because that's when their predators are least active. But, and in fact, unusually, the zebra that we saw giving birth the other day was just as it got dark. But I suppose these things can't always be timed to perfection. There was something else of vital importance I wanted to say about that. Oh, I don't think we see it that often because I think they do it in thick bush as much as possible. They don't give birth out in the open, but it's not impossible to see, especially during the lambing season or calving season around the beginning of the first rains. You do sometimes see impala, you do sometimes see wildebeest. Those are the two most common animals that you'll see giving birth. And I managed to see a zebra giving birth the other day. And that was just blind luck. We were driving along, and there it was. So we're going to drive out onto the southern boundary now, see what we can find around there, and then we'll probably head off to the east and up towards Bivelsdrift Dam, where we had that lioness last night. Now, oh, what I didn't tell you, I don't know how many of you were with us last night, but we had the lioness that was calling around Bivelsdrift Dam, and then we found another one on the way home. Now, she was much skinnier than the one that we had at Bivelsdrift Dam, but she had definite suckle marks on her. So I wonder if that wasn't the mother, and she was heading back towards Torchwood. So let's head towards Bivelsdrift Dam. Maybe something would have popped out there. We'll have a look and see. But nobody has found any lions today, and I know that Mike from Cheetah Plains has been knocking around that area for the last little while. Starting to warm up a bit now. Not so bright.
Yeah, a little bit.
How many jackets have you got on?
I've still got four on.
Still four? Four jackets. Hello, Jordan. You want to know what are some of the most interesting facts about lions that most people don't know? Jordan, I think one of the most common misconceptions about lions is that about extra to the side is females and their youngsters. The males within their territories will have what, two or three crowds. They are sort of noble hunters. What else would we say the most interesting facts, little known facts about lions? I mean, there are so many, depending on, you know, the level of depth that you want to go into. But I think those are two of the most obvious misconceptions of lions. Should be very nice. So let's drive a bit quicker and see if we can't pick something up the other side. Everything is falling apart.
The elephant technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Department will be working on getting us back up and running as quickly as possible. As you know, bringing you live safaris from the middle of the African bush is not always the easiest task in the world, but we will be back up and we return.
Not this thing. It's like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
Hi everyone, we are experiencing technical difficulties, but please bear with us. Our engineering department and our tech department will be working on getting us back up.
Sorry about that, but we're back and we are here now on Leadwood Road. We're about to turn onto Leadwood. We've just gone past Twin Dams where there's some excavation going on. And as I mentioned yesterday, that is because of a suspicion that this dry season is going to be succeeded by a very heavy wet season. I'm not sure where or if that's going to happen or not, but we'll see. Now we're going towards Bilbozuk Dam. We should probably be there in the next 15 minutes or so, depending on whether we see Karula and her cubs and lions killing buffalo, that sort of thing. But given the success of the day so far, I suspect that is going to be unlikely. I haven't seen a track of one predator other than those quite old leopard tracks earlier this morning. Very few hyena tracks too, which I think is very unusual. So maybe they have moved den. Probably not to around where I'm sitting now. Some more elephant tracks. Let's see what else we can find around here. In the meantime, back up and running is Stefan the Mystic Farmer. And so let's head across and see what he has to show you.
I don't know how much of a mystic farmer I am, because if I was mystic, I'd be able to predict what was inside this hole. Now, you caught us just sneaking up the side of this termite mound, and it's always a good thing when you're sneaking up to a hole like this to have a look inside to see if it's not inhabited by anything. This one isn't, thankfully, so we can show you what's inside there. It's a resting place. It actually looks like it's a collapsed tunnel. It looks like something's been digging in there, probably an ant bear. But it's allowed us now to come up to the top of this termite mound and sort of survey our domain, for lack of a better word. There's an elephant herd here. You were actually just with that elephant herd with James before we had that little technical glitch. And they were moving in this direction. So we've come here. There's lots of big termite mounds in this area. So it allows us one of these views across the bush. Now, to give you an idea of what it's like when we're in the bush, I'm looking straight into these trees, normally. So Jennifer wants to know why we always choose these termite mounds. You know, is it for safety? Is it to get a more domineering position? Is it just to see into the bush? It's actually a little bit of both, Jennifer, to be honest with you. Or all three things, not both. Yes, I use termite mounds to get a view over the bush so that we can see what it is that we're walking into. I also use termite mounds as a bit of a height advantage. Animals don't like people. They especially don't like people that are big and standing silhouetted against the sky. And so for me, a place of safety has always been termite mounds. I always look for termite mounds when I'm walking, and I'm always using it as a place of retreat if we had to walk into big stuff. In this particular occasion, I'm using it to scan across and survey the path ahead, basically. But for instance, if there was an elephant herd approaching us, which there is, we just don't know where it is, but if they were in close proximity to where we are, I would actually use this as a place where we'd make, not a stand, that has some negative connotations to it, but it's a place where we're relatively safe. It's a place where we're standing higher than we would normally. And as you can see right now, whereas before I was higher than all of these bushes, at the moment I'm standing looking straight into this wall of green that you see with us right here. Now, I always get distracted. It's one of those things with the bushwalk that although I have a plan in my mind, very often the plan is usurped by some movement in the bush or a noise or an interesting smell or, you know, like those caterpillars from a little bit earlier. Just something interesting on a branch that I've never seen before. And this area, although it is not that scenically pretty, I must be honest, it's quite a productive area. And Natasha, all the way from Ontario, says she doesn't really like spiders, but she's learning to respect them on bushwalk like this. Natasha, we can absolutely find you a spider. Give me a little bit of time just to find the most suitable stump, and let's see what we can pull out of the spider catalogue for you. I'm obviously not going to be looking for spiders in a clearing like this. Looking for spiders this time of the day, in a clearing like this, is not where you're going to be finding them. What you want to try and do, especially for the net building spiders, they're the easiest ones to find, the ones that build a web. we're going to be walking into an area where they can anchor their web between trees. So what I'm going to be looking for is an interesting place for a spider to anchor their web. And here would be a good bush, and we can see what is here. Oh, Siberias, you've caught me with a question there. How do we find the difference between a wolf spider and a funnel web spider if their webs are not present? That's a good question, Siberia. What I'm gonna try and guess at the answer to that. I'm gonna say that wolf spiders are better prepared for a mobile life. Wolf spiders are nomadic and they're hunters. They don't have webs, they're not sedentary. And funnel web spiders are spiders that live in a tunnel. Their bodies are going to be developed or skewed towards both of those things. So I'm going to say that a wolf spider is going to be built for speed. It's going to have all 8 of its legs probably roughly around about the same size, and also in a circle around its body. It's also going to have eyes that are forward facing and probably on top of its head rather than sitting on the front of its face. Funnel web spiders are going to have its frontmost legs more developed than its back legs. The reason for that is that they come out of their web and grab whatever prey that they are grabbing from the front of their web. They're also going to have almost all of their eyes facing forward so that it faces the light up from their tunnel. So if I were to guess, and this is literally just a guess, I haven't got a book in front of me and I wouldn't be able to answer your question without that. I would say that the wolf spider would be more designed for running, round spider, eyes all over the place. Funnel web spider, front four legs more developed than the back four legs, with its eyes more front, or more on the front part of its cephalothorax. Hopefully, Siberia, that worked for you. Please let me know if I'm correct. All right, and while we are looking for something interesting, we are going to link to James, who's just bumped into an elephant.
Well, it's a herd of elephants, actually, everybody, and it's wandering through the relatively thick bush here. And of course, as we go towards the winter, or into deeper into the winter, so the elephants will be found more and more in the woodland areas as opposed to the clearings. And that, of course, is because that is where there is stuff to eat at this time of the year. Now, there's one coming out behind us, Brian. I'm just going to reverse and see if we can't see that one. Attempt not to... Oh, dear. Hang on, everyone. I just reversed into a stump. Hello, Wendy. You're in Nebraska, and you say, do the elephants get more aggressive during a drought? Wendy, I don't think they get more aggressive. They will become more stressed, and of course, as you know, when you're stressed about whatever it might be, your temper is likely to fray more readily than it is at other times when you're comfortable and happy. So I think what you'll find is they will become a little bit more testy as the drought progresses, but they won't become more aggressive necessarily. Aggressive is the one word out here. There are two words out here that I try and avoid at almost all costs. One is dangerous when describing an animal, and the other is aggressive. Now, I don't believe any animal is inherently either aggressive or dangerous, except perhaps the human being. We're quite dangerous, aren't we, Brian?
Yeah.
Now, this one is definitely pregnant, I think. When you say something like definitely pregnant, I think, it means, as you've said definitely, you think to yourself, maybe I'm wrong. But you see that swelling there on the underneath the spine, you might just be able to make it out. But I think that's the picture of a little fetus growing. I did say that once, however, after I'd been out of the bush for a while, and the elephant in question, the pregnant elephant in question, promptly popped out an appendage between its back legs that is not normally found on a female elephant. It can sometimes be quite difficult to tell the difference. We're most embarrassed here. The reason I started to hedge my bets a little bit there is because this elephant has got quite thick tusks, which is unusual for a cow. I'm still pretty sure that's a cow though. Very peacefully eating. Be time for a picular. You can just feel, I don't know, well maybe you can't, but there is a feeling out here of sort of great peace and quiet as the morning starts to heat up. Now just remember, you can send through any of your questions that you'd like to, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. We'd love to hear from you. Send us your comments, and even if you don't want to talk about whatever we're seeing at a particular time, any questions about Africa or the surrounds are most welcome. And so, more and more, it will be difficult for these animals to find things to eat, of course. But elephants are pretty selective, and you'll see this cow here is very specifically selecting for what looks like young silver cluster leaf. A silver cluster leaf is the tree that she's sort of standing underneath there. And she's breaking off the young leaves. Now move forward a bit, Brian. Will that help?
No.
There we are. Joshua, what a lovely question, all the way from Kentucky. You said, do I think that elephants can hear the difference in each other's calls? Will they recognize each other from their calls? I have no doubt in my mind that they will, yes. I'm sure the closer they are, the easier it'll be for them, in the same way that the closer you are to... a person you know, the more readily you'll recognize their voice. But yes, I think these animals are absolutely able to hear each other. We know that lions can. We can watch and observe the different way that lions react to different calls. So when they will often respond to familiar calls and specifically avoid responding to unfamiliar calls. Yes, that is not a cow, everyone. That is a bull. That is a young bull, and therefore unlikely to be pregnant, wouldn't you say, Brian?
Very unlikely.
Yes. Almost impossible, you'd say.
Yeah.
Now, the reason I can tell that is because he has got no swelling between his front legs. Now, I think this is quite interesting because it's the second time I've been conned by that swelling on the side of the elephant. And I've immediately assumed it to be pregnancy when it actually is not. How's your picture? Your picture's right there. But you can see between the front legs there is absolutely no swelling at all. It's definitely not a female. Let me just call this in as well. Stationed is a small breeding herd of elephants on Leadwood Road, just to the west of the big clearings. There we can see him eating away. Now he's eating a zebra wood. Is he? Or is that a knobthorn? Let me try and Kirsten's powerful binoculars on the tree. It is a zebra wood. Now, zebra wood is not something you want to tangle with. And interestingly, in areas where there are no elephants, it grows into a huge tree from which you can make very sort of expensive, exclusive musical instruments like clarinets. But out here, you wouldn't so much as make a dog whistle out of that wood, because the elephants break the trees and they just turn into scraggly, fairly terrifying bushes with very vicious thorns on them. Elephants don't seem to mind them in the slightest. He's got an itchy ear. You see he's scratching his ear there. And you might just be able to hear him crunching away. Crunch, crunch,
flapping his ears as it starts to get warmer. He's definitely got a very itchy ear. In the same way that you know a dog's got an ear infection if it shakes its head from side to side. So an elephant will scratch its ears with its trunk. Oh, he's got a very itchy ear. What do you think he's got? Do you think he's got a bit of wax in there, Brian?
Bit of a wax built up.
But, well, fortunately he can't really blast it, can he? I imagine the wax build up in an elephant's ear would be quite impressive to see. And that's a tremendously hard wood. It's one of the hardest woods that there is out here. And just, I think it is, yes, it is denser than water. And so it too will sink, a very big piece of zebra wood. And I think it's one of their defensive mechanisms against being totally destroyed by elephants. What's interesting as we watch this now, although we as human beings would say, well, you see, look at the way the elephant is damaging that tree. He's pulling it apart. And it doesn't sort of grow large, and it's never going to be a sort of great big impressive canopy providing tree. But of course, to the tree, it makes almost no difference at all, because it's still alive. Its biomass is probably not much less than it would have been otherwise, and it will produce its fruits and it will breed. And so, although it looks like a scraggly, unhappy bush, it really isn't. And indeed will probably thrive with the attentions of elephants because they've evolved with the elephants. Now Stefan, of course, who is a master tracker of various different things, not least of which are the arachnids, has got something interesting to show you.
I have to say thank you to James for the compliment, although I'm quite far from a master tracker. But Natasha, we have managed to find you your spider, and here it is at the end of the grass that I've got here in my hand. This is a tiny little orbweb spider. I don't know what orbweb it is. Probably going to be close to a bark orbweb or just one of the more common garden orbs, but just a brown one. This one has got typically got the beautiful orbweb, and then it's got these lovely brown markings on it. It's for me quite pleasant. I quite enjoy shades of grey and shades of brown on a spider, and this particular one has exactly that. Now she's tiny. She is, as you can see, probably no more than half the size of my thumbnail there. But she's very cleverly built her orb web in a gap between some trees that's catching some breeze, and she's orientated her web exactly perpendicular to the breeze. In other words, the wind is blowing from myself to you, and or the other way around, from you to me, and is blowing insects through the gap in this tree. It would be a natural funnel for flies and for insects, and she's now gone and put her web in almost the perfect place for herself. Orb web spiders, or vertically aligned round or radial spider webs, are perfectly designed to catch flying insects. Not large flying insects, for that she'd need some entrapment snares, for a spider of her size at least anyway. She is there primarily to catch small flying insects. That's what she is designed to catch. That's what she's keyed to catch. And she'd use this beautiful web. The web is about as big as my hand. So I've got my fingers on both sides of my hand now spanning her web. She's got a web as big as my hand, which is not admittedly the biggest thing out there. And she's sitting dead center in my palm at the moment. So Natasha, I hope you enjoyed that one. This isn't a big, scary, hairy one with lots of bright colors. This is a pretty benign gray female orb web spider from something. I hope you enjoyed that. We'll try and find you something a bit more scary as we go along. All right. Now we're still in this thicket and we're still busy looking for those elephant that you had a little bit earlier. So far, absolutely nothing is giving us a clue that they're here. The bush is dead silent. We've got an oriole that's calling in the distance, which is a type of bird, a yellow bird with a black head, and that's probably about the only sound that I'm hearing. We just had a hornbill come and land here. I might be giving Jandre a little bit of a difficult task. in New Zealand, just looking at this, at these hornbills, have actually just asked me if I have a favorite bird song. And I must say, I actually do, Aaron. The Hughlin's Robin is, for me, the best bird call in the morning. The Hughlin's Robin. I'm going to walk a little bit closer to these hornbills. I want to have a look. Male yellow-billed hornbills, which is what you're having a look at here, the southern yellow-billed hornbill, have got a red wattle underneath their chin. So basically where their beak goes into their face. Oh, he's caught something. Oh, no. Let's go and have a look what he dropped there, Jandre. This hornbill picked something off of the branch and then dropped it. Here we're standing right underneath him. It's just a leaf, I think. But have a look up there. You can now see we're in a pretty bizarre angle for one of these guys. I'm obviously not going to stand right underneath him. And for those of you who are craning your necks to see him, just remember to keep your mouth closed at this angle. Definitely a piece of advice that I'm trying to take myself. And that was actually aimed more at Jandre than anything else. We're not directly under this hornbill, so he can't ambush us. Ah, and he's flown away. And that was a he. Now this time of the year, southern yellow-billed hornbills fly around in family flocks, male and female, with some of their, I'm not going to say unweaned babies, they are weaned by the time that they leave the nest, but they will be feeding together as a flock, moving through the bush, looking for almost anything. I've had the pleasure of looking after a yellow-billed hornbill that lost a wing, and I can say that they are probably one of the most industrious birds next to parrots that I've ever come across. Very good at finding food and opening up nooks and crannies with their beaks. But I think James has got an update for us. Not quite sure what he's found, but I'm sure that with James's brain, he's found something fascinating for you.
Now, sitting on a log like this has always reminded me of those wonderful Mark Twain books, Tom Sawyer, of course, and Huckleberry Finn, and whiling away the day on a log, watching the world go by with a piece of grass hanging from your mouth is a tremendous way to spend a bit of time. Now, this particular piece of grass is quite interesting, and I'm going to bring it across to you and show you now. But before I do that, what I want to try and show you is a butterfly, and I'm going to move with great stealth, Brian. Observe my stealth. Now, this butterfly is going to start to warm up now because the day is warming up, and so it may well fly away. It is, ooh, you see it? It's an African joker, everyone. Got him there? And he's opening and shutting his wings, so the hemolymph, which keeps the hydraulic pressure in his wings and allows them to sort of flap with a bit of speed, is heating up. And as it heats up, so he will probably take off as the sun starts to warm his body. They are, of course, completely ectothermic, which means they get no heat from within their bodies at all. There he goes. And there are a number of, actually, I'm surprised by the number of butterflies. Around on this plant, there are a couple of blues, which are going to be almost totally impossible to see with that camera. But a number of different blue species and a broad-bordered grass yellow. Now, there are two interesting things here. The first is this leaf. Now, a leaf, of course, in and of itself is probably not the most fascinating thing in the world when you are surrounded by large predators. But in the absence of predators, this particular leaf is interesting because it's been eaten by something called a leaf tear. And a leaf tear is normally a kind of caterpillar. Now, most of us would think of a leaf, of course, as being almost two-dimensional. Okay? But it isn't two-dimensional, it's three-dimensional. And it does have a very narrow width, of course, and that width is exploited by what we call a leaf tear, and it lives in between the two dermal or epidermal layers, which are the outer layers of the leaf. It lives between them and eats the cells out of the middle. So even though this leaf is probably what? It's probably about 10 cells deep, I imagine. So there is a caterpillar that has learned and evolved to exploit that food resource, which I just think is absolutely incredible. So that's the leaf. Then the other thing is this rather special piece of grass. Now, it's not a particularly good Tom Sawyer or Huck Finn grass because it doesn't taste good. And it doesn't taste good because it is called turpentine grass. Now, turpentine, of course, you all know, is a byproduct of oil distillation, and it's highly flammable, and it doesn't taste very good. Now, Brian, if you put that in your hands and do that to it, you smell the turpentine. He's not looking that convinced, I have to tell you. Yes?
Yes.
Oh, good. Phew. Okay. So everybody, take a deep breath in and imagine sticking your nose into a bottle of turpentine. Don't do that because you'll probably singe your nasal passages. But that's what it smells like. And the whole stalk is infused with whatever chemical that is. And so are the leaves of this plant. And it means that it is really unfavored by grazers. Grazers won't like to eat it at all. And it's got a lovely Latin name which kind of warms up the mouth, and it's called Cymbopogon excavatus. Cymbopogon excavatus sounds like a sort of Roman general, don't you think? General Cymbopogon excavatus.
Or a Harry Potter spell.
Yes, or a Harry Potter spell. Right. Yes, well done. Probably even more so than a Roman general. All right, we're plugged back in. We still haven't managed to reach Biffle's Hook Dam yet. We will do our best to get there. On we go. Judy H., you say, new sweater and new jacket on the James Hendry fashion show today. Well, you know, I am a very fashionable person, Judy. This jersey was brought to me from England during my leave. And that's because in South Africa it's almost impossible to get a plain wool jersey. And this is a nice spiky hard wool jersey, which is ideal for living in the bush. The jacket, of course, is not new. It just has graduated from being my sort of slightly bushy town jacket into being my slightly, well, you know, it's lost its colour and stuff, so now it's my bush jacket. Thank you, Judy, for noticing the efforts I make with my fashion. That is, of course, entirely sarcastic. Justin. You say you highly doubt it. I think you're in Arkansas, aren't you, Justin, if I'm not mistaken? You say you highly doubt it, but has it ever snowed in South Africa? The answer is yes. It snows every year in South Africa, just in very limited areas. Justin, South Africa is pretty big. And, I mean, it's probably the size of... What would it be the size of in the US? I guess it's... The US is probably five times the size of South Africa, so I mean it's still a pretty big country. And in the highlands, on the mountains, in the Drakensberg, it snows every year. It doesn't ever form sort of decent powder that you can ski on. You can ski in two places that I know of in South Africa, but they've only got sort of one run each. But mostly the snow forms ice very quickly. But that's only in the high-lying areas. But you can tell immediately where an area is snowed, and I've mentioned this before, by whether or not there is a local word for snow. There isn't a local word in this area for snow. And so you can be very sure that although snow has been seen on the mountains to the west of here on extremely cold mornings, very unusually, probably once every 10 or 12 years, it's never snowed where we're sitting now, no. But up into the highlands of South Africa, and even in Johannesburg, which of course is the economic hub of the country, it does snow every 10 or 12 years or so. But never to the extent that there are snow drifts that people have to, you know, kind of shovel snow and that sort of thing. I mean, Brian, you had an experience, you said the other day, and you had a proper blizzard in Johannesburg once. Yeah.
It was in 2012.
In 2012, yeah. But very, very unusual. There is a word in Zulu for snow. It's a wonderful word, and it is ikwa. But there's no word for that in Shangaan or Tsonga, which is the local language here. Thank you, Justin. Very nice question. I'm very glad it doesn't snow here, to be honest. Well, we're getting into the area where we had those lions last night. I think Mike from Cheetah Plains has driven around here today, so they're probably not around, but maybe one of them has popped out onto the road. We'll have a look and see. Obviously. So like I say, the female that is lactating, or the lactating female that we saw yesterday, was wandering this way. I'm really interested that she was further away from the baby, seemingly, than the one that was roaring last night. I think they were both roaring at each other, but the one that we had, when she stood up, she was very fat, and she might actually be pregnant, but she didn't look like she was lactating. I can't wait to see those little cubs. They are, of course, my favorite thing to see in the bush. And Kay Place, you're interested in what the life expectancy of a lion in this area is. Kay, it depends on the lion, but not very long, you'd be amazed to know. A male lion seldom makes it beyond 10 or 12 years. A female probably up to 14, if she's lucky. In captivity, they'll live up to 20, but out here, very unlikely to live beyond that. And the survival rate, 1 in 10 males makes it to adulthood and to take a territory, and females to adulthood much higher, probably about 4 in 10 or so. So still not very high. And that's because they live lives that are, they're very physically demanding, and in terms of the males, they're fighting all the time. And Justin, you say you're in Idaho, you're not in Texas. Sorry, in Arkansas. I thought you were from Arkansas, but you're not. Northwest in Idaho. Okay. I'm not sure. I think if you were to take the state of Idaho and you were to maybe quadruple its size, if I'm thinking of the right state, I might not be, then you'll probably get roughly the size of South Africa. Now, we're heading towards Biffleshoek Dam, and Kirsten is going to show you a map of where that is, and we're in the northeast corner of Juma. Have a look. We are, of course, attempting to make those slightly higher resolution maps, but it is really nice, I think, that you can now see exactly where we are, and I'm not sure if the GPS is working at the moment, but you may find that there was a little flashing dot, which was my vehicle. Was there? Not yet, but that will eventually be the case where you'll see the GPS of the car moving on the map, and that's quite fun. Assuming I don't knock the aerial off before then, of course. It is amazing how it has changed. Here we go. Here's this lioness. But going this way, on top of all vehicle tracks. Ooh, we might be lucky here. But the bush has changed in the last 2 weeks profoundly. It's got a lot drier. And certainly the leaves have gone a lot more yellow. Brian, do shout if you see a lion, will you? Tracks have gone off that way. That's not surprising, because they often then pop out again. They take a bit of a shortcut, the lions. They're not wont to take too much extra time. Make too much extra effort. Right, the lions are going straight down this road here. Just going to find out from Mike if he'd managed to check Biffleshoek Dam. Mike, did you check Biffleshoek Dam today? Okay, copy. I've got tracks of this pride heading down Hippo Pools Road towards the Fusuk Dam. I'll give it a look. So he has not checked the dam. Let's keep an eye out here in the thick bushes. Oh, it would be very nice to see a lion again. I thought I may have seen something there. Yes, impala. Unlikely to be lions there, right, Brian? If there are impala lurking around. These tracks, I think, are from last night sometime, and of course, lions will move big distances. This is a male lion that's come down here. Ooh, two hippo here today. I think this male's come down and had a drink here. You would have heard the female calling. He probably had a drink here last night and then moved off. Anyway, let's stop and just have a listen and look and a see. But there are two hippopotami, and the one there is covered in terrapins. How many terrapins do you think there are there? Six or seven, yeah. That's quite fun. And there's the other hippo, looks like a younger one. One, two, three, four, five, six. Six freeloading terrapins. There's some squirrels alarm calling to the north of the dam, but I mean they could shout at anything this time of the day. So there's a herd of young male impala that was knocking about here. We'll do a loop around and see if we don't pick up those tracks around the other side to the north of the dam. Yeah, it looks like a single male that's come down here. Possibly responding to the calling of the female yesterday. But everything is getting that very sort of peaceful feeling of the mid-morning now, as the heat starts to build. And Kathy, you want to know the rocks are still on the dam edge. Well, Kathy, yes, they are. Brian will demonstrate them to you now. Thank you, Brian. There they are, and although they're a little bit unsightly, they are playing a very vital role in the life of the torchwood tree, whose shadow you can see there. This torchwood tree's roots are slowly being sort of inundated by the collapsing of the bank here, and so this, what we call... Oh, I see. Yes, Kathy, you make a very good point. Sorry, we're not talking about the Sergabian here. We're talking about the rocks that I placed that were, in theory, there to check the levels of the dam. Now, Kathy, they are there, but they have been moved. There they are. So if we look, Brian, if you look at those rocks on the edge there, I put those in a sort of arrow formation, and they seem to have been kicked about a bit, unfortunately. So it doesn't look to me like the water level has dropped here much at all. That's quite interesting, actually. I know I'm not convinced that that's a particularly effective way of measuring it, because thinking of it now, if a big herd of buffalo came down here or some elephants, they'd definitely move them. We're going to have to find another way of doing it. I may need to knock a stake into the ground with something quite heavy. I will consider that. Kathy, thank you for that. Anyway, just quickly onto this torchwood tree. It is being inundated by the collapsing bank, and so that's why the gabion is here. Well, Richard in New Zealand, you want to know why it is that there is great construction and excavation going on at the dams around here. You want to know if it's for flood control or for the animals or what it is. It's a bit of both, I guess. You can't really control a flood, but what the worry is that the dams will be broken if there's a large flood, and that, of course, will mean that water doesn't...